Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us this morning. Service is going to start. And if I can ask everyone to please stand.
On behalf of the family, I wish family and friends for being here to celebrate the life of Bernadette. My name is Dennis Ball, and I'm the pastor at the Free Methodist Church in Brampton, and I have the privilege of being Iris Chang's pastor, Bernadette's mother, who's Bernadette's mother. Listening to the stories from Bernadette's family about her life, I realized that no one can preach our funerals because we preach our funerals while we're alive. Someone wrote, "For none of us live for him or herself, and none of us die to him or herself." We know this is true because we know that Bernadette will always be part of our lives. We are all different persons as a result of Bernadette being part of our lives. Life will continue to say meaningful things to us as long as we live. She will always. I know that there are things that you have over these last few years eventually come to mind to Bernadette as long as you live. Two things in our lives than anything else, and the people that we meet. Part of us. Blessed be the God and Christ and the God of all comfort, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. See, regardless of how deep our personal faith in God, the death of a loved one makes each one of us feel keenly the personal loss. There's a sense of an aching void in which we think of the one that we have loved is gone. We miss the companionship of our loved one, and our grief is deeply personal. And in these times of loneliness and sorrow, the presence of friends and loved ones can be so meaningful. Certain strength comes from close personal presence of those who are dear to us. And the support and sympathy of friends are a wonderful source of strength. There is something very beautiful at the time of our personal grief about the many expressions of sympathy and the many small acts of kindness which those who are friends and relatives do for us and thereby show that they care. I believe Bernadette's family today can sense in the many expressions of kindness and thoughtfulness such care and sympathy being displayed, and I believe they are grateful. But whatever friends and loved ones may do at a time, God is our supreme source of comfort. To those who are cast down, he comes to lift up our drooping spirits. He calls upon us to find refuge in him. Paul writes this, "Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace in the time of need." God gives us an avenue of comfort in allowing us to draw confidently near the throne of his grace to receive mercy and grace to sustain us in our present need. And prayer is an open door into the presence of the Almighty. I know we find ourselves so often drawn there when we have needs to express to the Father who cares for us and who has shown us much that he cares. And so let us pray now. Our Lord, you who are the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, look with compassion, we pray, upon all gathered here now and those watching from afar, that our minds and our hearts shall be at your command. Grant that this service of comfort, which we now hold in your name, may bring to all a sense of heavenly nearness and great trust in you. And may the peace of Christ, even the peace that passes all understanding, abide in us and rest upon all those dear ones. We pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We are now going to sing a blessed assurance. The words are in your program.
Day, right? Well, I'm going to read 1 Corinthians 15, verse 52 to 57. The mystery of the resurrection. Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we all will be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised, imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on the immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in the victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of the sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I'd like to call up Barbara to share some favorite memories.
Hi, I want to thank everyone for coming. We were twins. Many of you know that. We followed each other into this world 5 minutes apart. On my birth certificate, it says that I am the firstborn, and on Bernadette's, it said that she was a secondborn. My earliest memory was we were toddlers and we're sitting side by side, and our mom had given us a bowl of something, don't remember what it was, I think it was soup, and she put us down to have our meal, and we were just playing around. And so she got really annoyed, and she said to us, put it to your head. And so simultaneously, we both picked up the bowl and put it on top of our heads, and then you could figure out what happened after that. My brother in the audience, he was, he's 3 years older, and we were toddlers, so we were about two or three, and he thought that was vastly amusing. My mom eventually found it amusing as well, too, because she does have a sense of humor. Growing up, people used to refer to us as though we were one entity. They would say, we're the twins. Are you the twins? But we did not mind at all, because we really enjoyed being twins. And we supported each other all the time. We were always together. And according to my aunt, Bernadette was the fun, laughing twin. My granddaughter, Sydney, is just like that. She loves to laugh. She has a sense of humor, and people really love her. And if you, when you looked at the screen, you'd have seen that Bernadette was the fun one. In our young pictures, I was the one with a scowl, looking sullen, and most of the time unhappy. But she was always happy. She was always having fun. And as we grew older, she was always hamming it up in front of the camera. One of the pictures that I found really, that I really liked was we were at Hope Gardens. And if you're from Kingston, Hope Gardens is a botanical garden in Kingston. And we were standing at the gazebo on the steps. So Bernadette and I were standing on one part of the step, followed by Marcia, and then Marilyn was on the bottom. And they had to give her mommy's purse because she was fussing and wanted something to hold. So they gave her that to keep her quiet. And Bernadette had her arms thrown around my shoulder, and she was hamming it up for the camera. In many of the pictures that you've seen as well, too, it continued into adulthood. When we went traveling, she always, wherever we were going celebrating, she always had that camera going around and taking pictures. And that's something that she really loved to do, and my kids would call her Shutterbug because she was always running around taking pictures. By the time we got to middle school, Bernadette's athletic skills, she was really a superb athlete. As a matter of fact, in our day, it was Don Quarry, who was the Jamaican track and field star. I think she could rival him in terms of speed. We saw many of her awards that she kept, which I thought was amazing because she was so organized. In some ways, we were exact opposite. She was so organized, and she had all the awards that she won while she was in school. She had her growth spurt before I did. Let's face it, I really didn't get mine. But I remember a situation. We went to the cinema, Carib Cinema. If you're from Kingston, you'd know Carib. And so we went in, and my mom went to pay for us to get in. And it was no problem with me paying the child's fare. But when it came to Bernadette, the woman wanted her to pay the adult fare. And my mom said to her, they're twins. And she looked at my mom and she said, you must think I was born yesterday. And so my mom didn't stop. And of course, eventually she got in the mail an apology from the management because of that snarky comment. We went through, and I credit my survival to Bernadette. Without Bernadette at my back, I don't think I would have survived to become an adult. There was one incident where we were walking. I always like to walk on the edge of the sidewalk. And so we're walking home, and I was balancing on the edge of the sidewalk. And there was a older boy coming towards us. And as soon as he saw me balancing on the edge of the sidewalk, he decided that he was going to stand and cut me off. So he came and stood in front of me, and he refused to move, and I refused to move. And he t- told me to move and he used a racial slur. If you're from Jamaica, you can probably figure out what that is. And then I responded in kind. He looked at me, shook his head, and walked around me. And Bernard never got angry. I was the angry twin. And who am I fooling? I'm still the angry twin. And so she said to me, one of these days, you're going to get us all killed. Fast forward, she went with me to Jamaica. That was the last trip we had. And she came because people who have toddlers know how much equipment that you need. So I had the car seat, I had the stroller and everything else for my granddaughter, Sydney. So Bernadette decided to come along because she knew I would need help. So while we were at the Hard Rock Cafe in Montego Bay, I was just a little bit ahead of Bernadette with Sydney. We were going to the shower because we had just left the beach, and Marilyn was tagging behind Bernadette as well. And this person came up to me and said to me, are you from China? And he said something about the coronavirus, and I said, no, I'm from Hong Kong. And I'm actually more scared of you with the chickpea. And while he was dumbfounded by my response, I walked along, and then Marilyn told us afterwards, and Bernard just looked at me and rolled her eyes like, you really haven't changed at all. You have not learned anything at all. And so that is how we were. Bernadette always had my back, or always had her back as well too. I could call her up, because one day I wasn't feeling well. And so I called her and I said, Bernadette, I need your help. And in tutus, Bernadette was at my door because I had Sydney and she was able to look after Sydney until my daughter was able to leave work and to come. Whenever I called Bernadette, my mother would always say, Bernadette, your other half is on the phone, or Bernadette, your other half wants to talk to you. On May 28, 2020, everything stopped. Stop all the clocks, cut off the telephone, prevent the dogs from barking with a juicy bone. Silence the pianos and with muffled drum, bring out the coffin, let the mourners come. Let the airplanes circle mourning overhead, scribing on the sky the message, she is dead. Put crepe boughs around the white necks of the public doves. Let the traffic policemen wear black gloves. She was my north, my south, my east and west. My working week and my Sunday rest. My noon, my midnight, my talk, my sun. I thought that she would be around forever. I was wrong.
Thank you, Barbara. We have a musical tribute, the prayer. I'm going to call Nicole for it.
Thank you.
Morning. I have to get used to this new normal. The second Bible reading will be taken from St. John 11, verse 23 to 27. And Jesus said to Martha, "Your brother will rise again, Martha," he said. "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I have believed that you are the Christ, the Son of God, even he who comes into the world." Here ends the reading of the word. And I just want to say thank you, everyone, for coming, and thank you for those who are watching. I also want to express on behalf of my family, which my brother will continue to do, when it's his turn to say it, we are overwhelmed with the outpour of support in prayers and in gifts and you name it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Marilyn. I'm now going to call Shalina to come forward to share some favorite memories.
To love her gospels, and it wasn't just a Sunday thing, it was an everyday thing for her. And one thing she always grew me up on is to always read my Bible and to always, she always had the daily bread for me to read. And I think, you know, as I got older, it grew me into the person that I am today. One thing I have to, a memory that I have to share about my mom is she loved the garden. Me and her would be always in the backyard, and we always would be planting or doing something in the garden. It was always in the garden where we used to spend our time. And then after that, we'll go in and then we'll eat ice cream or we'll watch TV together. One thing I have to say, she was very loving. She was strict but very loving, and I think that's what makes her the person that she is. And it just molded me into who I am today. And I want to thank her for all of that. I wish I had enough time to sit down and talk to her more. But unfortunately, God called her home.
Sharing those touching memories. We are now going to our next hymn, How Great Thou Art. Marcia for a poem tribute.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Thank you for coming out to celebrate my dear sister Bernadette's wonderful life. I will be reading a poem written and dedicated to Bernadette by our brother, Dr. Richard Deno in Jamaica, a country our dear Bernadette was so fond of. This poem, I will have to say, paints an accurate picture of who Bernadette was and one of her most admirable attributes. Butterfly. Emerging from its cocoon does a butterfly at birth, spreading its wings, ready to do God's work. From flower to bloom, in flight with no seeming end, feeding on a nectar and spreading pollen as I fly in the wind. The sun shines brightly, and the colors of my wings glow. Blue, black, orange, deep pink, and happy yellow. Going about life's journey, I do not tire. I bring joy and happiness for all to admire. The colorful flowers blown by a warm summer breeze, I move my wings and fly to each one with effortlessly ease. No noise I make it, doing my work in silent joy. I am here to bring glee and good. Nothing do I destroy. But the day will come that the butterfly will halt. My work in the garden is complete, and no one can find a fault. I look at the flowers in all their colorful glory, realizing that there is indeed an end to my story. And so the butterfly perches and folds its wings. The time has come to move on to better things. We may not realize that we are all beautiful butterflies in various shades that light up our eyes. And when a work in the garden is complete, all butterflies will reunite again. And in the garden of paradise, we meet. This is so appropriate, describing the way Bernadette, she was always like a beautiful social butterfly. And now that she has gained her heavenly angel wings, I can just imagine her in heaven now, flying around, socializing, and reuniting with all the angels who had gone before her. And her daddy, I can imagine sitting on the side, smiling and saying, "That's my girl. Yes, that's my girl." Good night, my sister. Good night. God be with you, and you be with God, until we meet again. Amen.
I'd like to call upon again Nicole for another musical tribute.
Thank you.
In around 900 BCE, there lived a king. Some of you might know, might have heard of King Solomon before today. This king had such wisdom that people traveled from around the world just to be in his presence, to be in his audience, just to hear what he had to say. In fact, some of the his wisdom is still around and part of our day today. Phrases like, there's nothing new under the sun, or there is a time for everything, a season for each activity under heaven, which actually inspired the famous song from the mamas and the papas, turn, 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 to everything there's a season. And when I was reading his writings, I came across this statement. And here's what he says. He says, it is better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting. For death is the destiny of every person. The living should take this to heart. In other words, what Solomon was saying is that it's better to go to a funeral than it is to go to a party. That it's better to visit a cemetery than it is to go to a sporting event. And as I reflect on this, as I was listening and hearing what he was saying, I think there are at least three reasons why Solomon wrote this passage. I think first, this is a time for us to celebrate the life that God gave to Bernadette. We're sad, but we also want to remember Bernadette's uniqueness. She was a mother, she was a daughter, she's a sister, and a friend. Bernadette cannot be replaced. Second, it's time for us to say goodbye to Bernadette. As hard as it is, my hope for this service is that this will help us begin the process of letting go. And third, it's time for us to take a look at our own lives. We are all going to die someday, and it's a great time to ask some tough questions. Questions like, am I ready to die? And where will I go when my life is over? When it comes down to it, this service is more for us who are living than for the person who has died. And so what we're going to do is that we're going to remember, we're going to say goodbye, and we're going to reflect on our own lives. Now, some of you are searching for answers this morning. I want you to know that it's okay to ask those questions. It's natural to wonder why this had to happen. You know, there's a story in the Bible that addresses some of the things that most of us are feeling today. It's found in what is known as the Gospel of John in the 11th chapter. And here we read of a funeral that involved hard questions, deep feelings, and budding hope. The deceased is a man named Lazarus, who comes from a very close family, among them two sisters, Mary and Martha. Like Bernadette, Lazarus came from a good family with a bunch of friends. And one of his best friends was Jesus. Jesus arrives 4 days after Lazarus dies. And as he approaches the house full of people crying, both sisters run out to him at separate times and say, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. I suspect that some of you are asking if questions as well. If only I had spent more time with her. If only I had been nicer. If only I had done this, or if only I have done that. These kinds of if questions are normal. But don't blame yourself. it's not healthy, and it's not right. Well, if we're not supposed to blame ourselves, then maybe God is to blame for this. That is the exact statement that both Mary and Martha make when they are grieving over the death of their brother. Remember what they said. They said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." I've learned long ago that it is really senseless to either accuse God or to try to defend him. But neither is it sinful to question him. Some of you are wondering why God would allow this to happen. It's okay for you to ask these kinds of questions. Jesus did not scold these sisters for suggesting that perhaps their brother's death was his fault. And you shouldn't feel guilty of wondering if there was something God could have done. God could have kept Bernadette from dying, but for some reason he didn't. It was Bernadette's time. Solomon also reminds us that there is a time to be born and a time to die. While we don't understand why Bernadette died, we do know it was her time to die. And as we continue in this story, we find the shortest verse in the entire Bible. Surrounded by family and friends, Jesus is deeply moved and asks where the body of Lazarus is. When he views where Lazarus' body is, he could have said something extremely profound. But instead, John tells us what he did. He wept. Here is Jesus of Nazareth, the Son of God, the most complete, the most perfect person, attending the funeral of a friend and openly weeping without embarrassment, without apology. In fact, those who were watching him said this, "See how much he loved him." If you feel like crying today, don't hold back. It's okay for you to cry. God feels your pain. He wants you to let it out and to let him into your feelings. He wants to help you work through everything that you're feeling. He wants to be part of your life. God knows what it is to hurt. One day he lost a family member too, his only son. And so this morning I have a question for you today. Where will you go when it's time for you to die? This is the question that we will ask ourselves in our lifetime, and how you respond to it determine how you will live today. See, Jesus responded to Mary and Martha and says, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies." Do you believe this? Jesus didn't merely say that there is a resurrection. He claimed that he is the resurrection. The fact that he would rise from the dead was a guarantee that others would too. We often think that this is the land of the living, and then when we die, we go to the land of the dead. But the opposite is true. This is the land of the dying. When our life here is over, we are transferred into the land of the living, either to a place of eternal joy or a place of torment. There are really only two possible destinations. And there's only one requirement for entrance into this resurrection life. It's not a matter of trying to be good enough. It's not even a matter of going to church. The only requirement is that you personally believe that Jesus exchanged his life for yours by absorbing your sins on the cross, and that he rose again so that at that moment of your death, you will rise too. Are you ready to do some spiritual business with God today? You can leave this place the same way you came. You can leave this place thinking for good, that you're good enough, with vague hopes of heaven, or you can leave here in full assurance that you will go there when you die. The choice is up to you. Determine today to put your faith and trust in Jesus as the Savior of your life. Scripture tells us, what is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then you vanish. Bernadette was not planning to die when she did. But since life is like a vapor that appears for a little while and then passes away, it was her time to go. None of us know what will happen to us either. Our lives are very fragile, aren't they? Solomon reminds us not to boast about tomorrow because we don't know what the day will bring forth. Some people are always bragging about what they're going to do, and they end up never doing anything. One of these days, I'm going to do this. I'll tackle that later. But later may never come. And so this passage gives us two significant reasons why we should never presume upon the future. First, life is unpredictable. We don't even know what will happen tonight, much less next week or next year. The truth is, no one can predict the future. And life is brief. Our lives are like a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. See, life is too unpredictable and too brief to live without Jesus at the center. See, we count our lives in years, but God tells us to number our days. The truth of the matter is that all of us are just one heartbeat away from eternity. We are told, yet, as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, there is only a step between me and death. Our lives are like a vapor, here one minute and gone the next. So don't put off this decision. Decide today that you will give your life to Jesus. Jesus says, whoever believes in me will live, even though he dies. Do you believe this? If not, don't waste another minute of the only life you have right now, right here. Decide to pin all your hopes on Jesus Christ and him alone, who exchanged his life for yours and who in the next life will greet you on the other side if you receive him into your life now. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the life of Bernadette. We thank you that we have been blessed by her being part of our lives and that she lives on in our memories. We also thank you for our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, in whom whoever believes shall live though they die, and whoever lives and believes in him shall not die eternally. We ask you to raise us from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that when we shall depart this life, may we rest in Christ. And we pray that the resurrection on the last day, we may be found acceptable in your sight and receive that blessing which your well-beloved Son shall then pronounce to all who love and fear you, saying, come, you blessed of my Father. Receive the kingdom prepared for you from the beginning of the world. O merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. I would like to call upon Clyde to come up for the acknowledgments.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for being here to celebrate my sister Bernadette. Before I do the acknowledgement, I'd like to just say a few words about Bernadette. For the past 12 years, I've had the privilege of living in the same residence as Bernadette. And during that time, I've come to realize that Bernadette was a really strong believer in Jesus Christ as her Savior. She had a favorite saying, if there are any issues or any problems, she'd go, leave it in the hands of the Lord. And she is always praying, and she really believed in praying, because she told me once that the reason why her faith is so strong when it comes to praying is that she gets results. Her prayers are never come back void. She tells me when she prays with purpose. So I've been living with her in the same residence for the past 12 years, and I've noticed that her lifestyle reflected her belief in our Lord Jesus Christ. Also, she was aware that she was worshiping the one and true God, because there, you know, there are many gods, right? But she knew which God she worshiped. She worshiped the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's the God she worshiped. And all through my 12 years living with her, as you know, because when I left Jamaica, she was still a teenager. So I didn't really grow up or be around her after we were teenagers. It's just recently, about 17 years ago, that I'm around her as adults, because I was in the States before I came here to Canada. So my growing up took place in the States. So I had the privilege of, you know, really knowing, getting to know her as an adult. So I just want to mention that she had a belief in Jesus Christ. And as a matter of fact, when she passed, I was the one who found her. And her last act was prayer, because her deceased body was in a position of prayer. She passed away on her knees. So I just want to leave that with you. I think I'll read the acknowledgement. Okay, on behalf of the family, I would like to acknowledge and thank the following people. Family and friends for their outpouring of love, comfort, and support during this difficult time. The organist, Keisha Wilson, for the beautiful playing of Bernadette's favorite musical pieces. Pastor Dennis for his words of comfort. Mrs. Grace Lewicki for her beautiful floral arrangements. The funeral director, Ms. Shari Yearwood, and her team for making this very difficult day run seamlessly. Terry, who provided the live stream so that family and friends could participate. Thank you.
So we have another congregational hymn, Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet.
also like to call up Nicole again for our final musical tribute.
Beautiful release, memories seep.
Nicole. Can we please stand for the benediction? May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us evermore. Amen. I'm now turning the service over to the director.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Chang family, I'd like to thank everyone for attending today's service. As service concludes, we'll be traveling to Brampton Memorial Gardens for the interment. The route we will take will have us leaving the funeral home. We'll make a right onto Derry Road. There is some construction up Derry, so we're going to try to avoid that. We'll make a right onto Hull, a right onto Airport Road, then we'll make a left onto Steeles, okay? So when we're making that left turn, please ensure you're obeying the rules of the road as we are not under police escort. We'll travel along Steeles until we get to Mavis, where we'll make a right. We'll travel along Mavis, crossing over Beauverde, which then turns into Chincoosey, and we'll make a right into the cemetery. Once we arrive at the cemetery, we will be traveling to the Garden of Eternity. Anyone who is traveling ahead of the funeral fleet, I'd ask that you please leave the way to the grave clear so that the vehicles do have access to the grave. At this time, in respecting social distancing, we'll have Pastor Dennis lead us out, followed by the family and the pallbearers, and then the rest of us will follow out. We'll exit the building. I'll ask that the pallbearers please wait at the main doors to the building so that you can help us with lifting the casket into the funeral coach. So the casket will come down after us. Okay, now on behalf of myself, Sherry Yearwood, and the rest of the New Haven family, I would like to thank you for allowing us to serve you. Okay, Pastor Dennis.
Hi, I'm Shelley Challenger, Vice President of the New Haven Funeral Center.
And I'm Sherry Yearwood, the Managing Director.
We take pride in offering pre-planning, shipping, personalized services, catering and reception options, all at our luxuriously bright and spacious facility.
New Haven Funeral Center, where we enter your family's lives as strangers, but leave as family.
Call us at 1-833-3-NEW-HAVEN or visit us at newhavenfuneralcenter.com.
Center is your New Haven.